I believe in America.
For it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game.
Take me out. Twitchy Dolphin Media presents Let's Get To. It's baseball from sea to shining sea by the team that brings you home. And now, your host, James Christopher.
And welcome to Let's Get To. This is our 4th of July episode. I'm your host, James Christopher, and I was taught early on in film school that nothing that is seen or heard in your movie can be a mistake. Everything that you see or hear has to be intentional, and using the iconic opening of The Godfather most assuredly fits our 4th of July episode because, well, I believe in America. I think it's really easy to be down on being an American now. The extreme media is dividing us, and too many of ourselves, including me, are allowing ourselves to be divided. It's easy to be angry. It's harder to think through things. We're divided on everything, including how we see ourselves. While America isn't the version that we learned in elementary school, it's not the fairy tale, it's also not the root of all evil that so many, including many of my fellow Americans, claim us to be. They'd rather focus on the negative than the positive. Now, America and the nature of its people, we've changed how we divide ourselves. We used to be a melting pot where all these traditions we brought with us from our homelands melted together into this new thing we call the US of A. You know, it's the reason why that there aren't just O'Toole's and O'Keefe's hammered on 6th Street on St. Patrick's Day. And it's the only logical reason that people are allowed to call a pig in a blanket a kolache. It's not. It's a Colbin-esque. Now, the melting pot proved problematic for some, and I definitely understand why. So then we went with a salad bowl metaphor, where we're all keep our heritage and our identity forefront, but we're all still Americans coexisting and making things a little bit better. And yet we're still calling a pig in a blanket a kolache. But it seems like we're heading to becoming the tray at the middle school cafeteria, where each one is in its own little space, separated, where neither the twain shall meet. And that doesn't ever work out in the long run. Just look at our own history. Recently, I've seen a push for 2 national anthems. No, there should only be one. It's a national anthem. Now, we can debate if the Star Spangled Banner should be it. I've often thought it should be changed to America the Beautiful. But the point of the anthem is to unite the country, not remind us of divisions. So, you know, not to, unless, you know, the Blue Jays are in town or back in the day, the Expos. When I think of the division and how I myself fall subject to the manipulation, I remind myself that this is still the country that people are risking life and limb to get here for. And while maybe it's harder to be that American immigrant story of the 20s where you're getting an opportunity to pull yourself up by your bootstraps, it's still not hard to find generational progress among immigrant families. Not many other places on the planet provide that. We should let the 4th be the day that unites us. The one day where we set all the bullshit aside that the extremes of our country want us to believe. The day where our differences are minor and being an American and connected by that should be the most important thing. And recognizing that while we might argue passionately, most of us are just trying to improve the country. And maybe recognize that George W. Bush and Barack Obama can both deeply love our country even if they have a difference of opinion in how to lead it. And that those two people can be different and still, gasp, be friends. I know it's hard to believe. So let's let the 4th be that day. Do the things we like to do. Hot dogs, beer, fireworks, lemonade, watch Jaws. See what happens to Chrissy Watkins. Watch Bill Pullman and Will Smith team up for some alien killing. And of course, go see some baseball. Drown out the Marjorie Taylor Greens, the MAGA right, and the radical left, and acknowledge that this is still a country that's still in progress, and that tomorrow, all of us, starting on the 5th, can work to make it a little bit better. But let's enjoy the 4th for what it is. Now, speaking of making things better, We've talked on the show how much Don Gillingham means to our show. It means to us personally now. And we want to continue to pray for Don and his son Tug as they continue to work through this very difficult time. They're strong, and we at the Let's Get To family have their back. Now, speaking of America and how it can be done right, let's head out to the Duboise County to see the Bombers and see a baseball community that knows what it means to be united.
On the St. Louis team, we have who's on first, what's on second, I don't know's on third.
That's what I want to find out. I want you to tell me the names of the fellas on the St. Louis team.
I'm telling you, who's on first, what's on second, I don't know's on third.
Do you know the fellas' names?
Yes.
Well, then who's playing first?
Yes.
I mean, the fellas...
Who's on first? Who? The Let's Get To team of the week.
And welcome back to From the Bleachers. I'm James Christopher, and I'm coming to you from the very iconic wooden bleachers of League Stadium, home of your Duboise Bombers and home of the iconic Rockford Peaches. Sometimes a ballpark and an experience can just grab you. The Duboise County Bombers was an experience that took hold and wouldn't let me go long after I returned to Austin. We picked this experience for our 4th of July episode for a reason. Really, for several reasons. The setting, the team, the community, it was all idyllic. The American dream in so many ways is a community united. And one of the ways that this community lives that union is through their baseball team. And how idyllic was it? Y'all, I saw a treehouse in town. Like a functioning treehouse built in a tree. That's like some Mayberry stuff, and I was here for it. So when I got to the game and I sat down in those wooden bleachers in a park made famous by an iconic movie, seeing friends and family joke, laugh, and get ready for the game, it was one of those moments that reminded me why we do this show. Baseball, no matter the size of the town or the park it's played in, is at its best when it brings people together. And where they come together is so ultimately cool. League Stadium is one of the oldest ballparks in the U.S., built in 1894. While it currently houses our Bombers of Duboise County, it's also played home to the Dragons, the Southridge Raiders, high school baseball, and the Rockford Peaches. Yep, more on that later. It's a beautiful park with old-fashioned wooden bleachers, a seating capacity of about 2,800, and these really cool brands in the outfield. You know, the sponsors. And while some of the sponsors are from the movie A League of Their Own, some of them are their current sponsors. All of the signs look like they were designed in the 1940s. There's nothing quite like it. The entire experience is designed to fit together seamlessly. In many ways, it reminded me of the Jersey Shore Blue Claws and how all of that felt like one thing. It felt intentional. That's the experience you get here. It's hard not to get caught up in the place, in the vibe they have around the park, how close you are to the action, and just how pristine the playing surface is kept. It all adds up to something pretty amazing. The caretakers of the experience are the husband and wife ownership team, Ara and Justin Knepp. The two of them form a focused, determined, hard-working dynamic duo determined to keep the Bombers tradition going strong, with its roots firmly in the past while it looks to the future. And being part of a husband and wife team myself, that angle attracted me to their story. We sat down with Justin to talk about the team, his partnership, and why he jumped into collegiate summer league baseball in the first place.
Well, we were minority owners for the last, 8, 9, 10 years, I'd have to think, but we've been minority owners, silent partners. We helped put up some money to keep the franchise here in Duboise County. My wife and my kids and I, we would come to 12 to 15 or more games every single season because it's about a 2.5 hour drive from where we live. So the opportunity came up where the main two principal owners about a year ago, so it would have been spring of 2022, asked us if we would be interested and willing to purchase majority control of the team. They are a little bit older. They were ready to take a step back. And so it just was too good of an opportunity to pass up. So again, we bought out the other owners to take over majority control. We still live 2.5 hours north of here, but we are living here in Duboise County in Huntingburg, Indiana, for 3 months here during the summer to manage and help lead the team day in and day out.
So generally how it goes, I pick a team to visit. In this case, it was the Rocket City Trash Pandas. I then, to make the travel feel worthwhile and more cost effective to the show, will look for other teams to cover within a 4-hour radius. There's lots of criteria that go into making this choice, and for as much as it might bug my old high school English teacher, we chose the logo. Yep, we literally picked a book by its cover.
I knew we wanted to rebrand. I knew we wanted to have like more of what I would consider a logo that has more of a modern day minor league feel. The credit for the idea of the bomber bat, I'm sorry, the bat as a bomber airplane, because again, we are the Duboise County Bombers. The idea came from Barton Lewis, who again is the third owner of the team. There's three of us. It's myself, my wife, and Barton. He had the conceptual idea of it. I then worked with a designer to actually create it and then fine tune it. I can't take full credit for it. It turned out better than what we could have imagined. We're very happy about it. We get a lot of compliments about it. And I'm glad you get it, because in what is still a very crowded baseball landscape, I think branding matters, marketing matters, finding ways to stand out and stick out matter.
Now, when you look at a baseball team in 2023, you have two audiences you have to think about. You have your regular devotees in your community, and you have this entire culture of ballpark chasers and gear collectors. Justin knew this full well as they approached redesigning the brand.
We get, I don't even know how many thousands and thousands of visitors who come to visit our ballpark every year who are just baseball enthusiasts, baseball fans like you. And so again, we do the best job that we can with a lot of the decisions that we make to make sure that, yes, we are appealing to that hyper-local audience, which is, you know, here in Duboise County and the surrounding counties, but we are still trying to do things that keep the rest of the world in mind. And I think that's all that any, I think that's what every team should be doing, of course, right? We've made a big effort to do that.
I'm a movie guy. I'm a baseball movie guy. Field of Dreams being shot at League Stadium is just the coolest. Cooler still is how they blend the movie into the entire baseball atmosphere and how much the ownership team realizes it's a great front porch to the ballpark and the Bombers.
Oh, I think it's so important. And to your point, when you walk in the stadium, it's undeniable, the league of their own presence, everything from the Peaches wine bar, which you saw and hopefully tasted when you were here.
Oh, I had the peach thing.
The famous peach wine slushy. Unbelievable. You know, you have that. When you walk in, we also have that sort of display, kind of looks like a little museum area that has some of the props from the actual movie, the lockers that the girls had that were used in the movie. We have a TV in there that's showing the movie. We have what I think is the first designated crying area in a baseball stadium that fans, it's a great photo opportunity. You know, we have that as well, which is incredibly fun for people. So the League of Their Own, my gosh, that's now, what, 25, 30 years ago? But that movie is still very beloved.
It's one thing to have a classic movie shot of the ballpark, but how do you manage that with the Bombers brand?
We embrace it, and the fans still do too.
Yeah, I had the privilege of talking to one of your peaches, which essentially is the sort of the spirit group of the Bombers. And I thought one of the things that struck me was this movie's obviously important. It's a very sort of pro-feminist, but does it in the best way possible movie. And to see young women in your community see the peaches and then at some point want to come back from college and continue to be peaches. How much of that is just sort of maybe a cool thing you didn't know was going to be part of the reality, and here it is?
Yeah, well, I think a lot of it. We're always talking about the peaches in general. You know, they do a great job of keeping things moving and entertaining off the field during the game. And I think maybe to the point you were making, we do get a lot of them who come back year over year. A lot of our staff who come back year over year. The big thing that we are continuing to do this year is to continue to find ways to keep our staff motivated and keep them happy. And again, it takes a village to get it to run a game, I think. And so the Peaches are a great example of that. But I think all of from the top down, everyone who's involved with making the game day experience memorable and special, you know, we do tend to see that a lot of them, they've been doing it for years, and we hope that they're going to continue to do it for many years to come.
It was fascinating to talk to Justin about him owning the team with his wife, Ara. As someone who works closely with my own spouse, that's right, the first lady of minor league baseball, my wife, Jessica, I know how it can feel to have its bumps. But for Jess and I, it's way more rewarding than it is stressful, and it's something that neither of us could imagine doing without the other. So how does Justin feel about sharing a job with the person he also shares kids and a home with?
I love it. I love that we argue about stuff. I think we argue because we care, right? We care about making this an incredible experience for our fans, an incredible experience for the players. I love it. I love being able to work with her. It's so much fun. Again, when you were here visiting, we were joking about, again, what it's like to work with our spouses and the challenges and the arguments. But at the end of the day, I wouldn't change it. She does an incredible job with what she does on the team. And so I guess the short way to sum it up, yes, it is challenging, but at the same time, it's very rewarding, and it's a lot of fun to be able to spend this extra time with her doing something that we both really care about and really love.
Now, these two are hands-on and in every part of the entire ballpark experience. Ara runs the in-game experience, managing the games in between inning fun. And between taking tickets, mixing drinks, and fixing the technology, Justin seems to be doing, well, everything else.
That's the stuff that's fun to me. That's the stuff that's fun. I mean, you know, this first year especially, we wanted to be very literally hands-on of understanding every aspect of what happens on game days, everything that happens in the 9 months leading up to that first game day. So we are very hands-on, but I got to be honest, that's the stuff that's also fun. The next night after you left, because I just thought it would be fun, I got in the mascot costume. I got inside the Buzz costume. And that was the most fun I've had so far this summer. And so, you know, we don't want to be owners who just sit back and, up in their seats and just watching the game. And we love watching the game, but we want to be out interacting with the fans and helping and being hands-on. And who doesn't want to make one of those famous wine slushies that you saw? Those are fun. So, this first year we knew was going to be very time intensive, very hands-on. But we're enjoying every minute of it.
Now, at the minor league level, look, the game is one thing, but we all know the joke. People don't really know who wins a minor league baseball game. It's about having fun and having a great night out. These two do a great job of building an entire experience for the fans from the minute they walk into the ballpark to the minute the final out is recorded.
Well, we appreciate that. It makes me happy that guys like you, with the national audience, recognize that. It does mean a lot. We can't take full credit for it. Again, the previous owners did an incredible job of building this foundation of what I always refer to as the Bombers experience, what the Bombers experience is like coming to one of our games. We did implement dozens of new changes this season. But again, I think I got to give them the credit of they did a lot of the heavy lifting of creating this fan base. And again, their names were Mike and Mary Ubelar. Absolutely incredible job. Mike and Mary, if you're watching, thank you. You guys made our job significantly more easier. It's now our job to take it to that proverbial next level. And I think that we're doing that. We're starting to see that. We published and shared something on Facebook and our social media yesterday. You know, our season ticket sales were up 64% this season.
Oh, great.
It's a nice metric. It's one of many metrics. But at the end of the day, it's our job to create fans. It's our job to keep fans. And so I think we are well on our way in doing that. But part of that is a huge thank you. And a huge thank you to the Mike and Mary Ubelar, the previous owners who helped just get us to this point.
The ownership group is in year one of their tenure, and as we've learned in 5 years of doing this show, you do year one while you're planning years 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on.
We have so many crazy ideas. Year one was really truly a learning year. I think the experience, if you had a good time when you were visiting us here recently, here in 2023, you got to come back and visit us in 2024. give us a year to fully understand what we're doing. And 2024 is going to be way better. I can already tell you that. And I'm not just saying that. The thing about my wife and I and Barton is we're learners. So we learn very quickly of what works well for our fans, what works well for our players, what works well for our coaches. And we will make those adjustments to make 24 even better. So it's still early this season, but we're already so excited for what next season looks like for our fans and our players as well.
You have to work to be on the forefront when you're in minor league baseball. And these guys dance on the edge, which explains embarrassing walk-up song night.
Hey, man, I'm worried that these players are going to get so embarrassed that they may have to call their moms. They may not be able to finish the game. It's going to be pretty cringy. It's going to be pretty awkward and embarrassing. Our fans are pretty excited about it tonight. This was one of those promo nights that has been circled on my calendar for many months. So, again, that's tonight. I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
We finished the conversation excited by a future trip to League Stadium. As I get older and continue doing this thing, I find that there are experiences that really capture my heart, and this is absolutely one of them. It's perfectly on theme, from the peaches and the bombers. From the buses to the signs, it's a great shared pairing. It's a place where they have a great time doing whatever it is that they're doing. From trying to get some Guinness Book of World Records, like the most people leapfrogging at once, or the most people to say a movie line. These two actors, by the way, are the cutest because, well, they're not actors, they were draftees. League Stadium, home of your Duboise Bombers, is the perfect spot for cinephiles, baseball fans, and cinephile baseball fans. It's welcoming, it's fun, it's relaxing, and I cannot wait for the rest of the world to find this little hidden gem in Indiana.
Let's Get To presents Lights, Camera, Playball, Inside Baseball Cinema.
And we're back here on Lights, Camera, Playball. And look, if you're going to have an episode where you review a league of their own, you might as well start it in the designated crying area of League Stadium, home of your Duboise Bombers. And welcome to another edition of Lights, Camera, Playball. And look, let's get this out of the way first. Anyone who says there is no crying in baseball must not have seen me the night of Game 7 of the 2019 World Series. Trust me, there were tears aplenty.
That's down the right field line into the corner. This ball is gone for a home run!
A League of Their Own tells the story of the All-American Girls Professional Baseball League, a professional baseball league for women designed to fill in the baseball gap during World War II. With so many ballplayers off the fight, like in many other walks of life, women stepped up. The league would live long past World War II, running until 1954. Now, the film follows women from all walks of life as they get a chance to chase a dream. The cast features an all-star lineup that really knocks it out of the park. You've got underrated actress Gina Davis playing Dottie, the reluctant ballplayer turned star catcher. Tom Hanks is Jimmy, former slugger turned functional-ish alcoholic manager that's frankly, honestly, barely functional.
Lord, I'd just like to thank you for that waitress in South Bend. You know who she is. She kept calling your name.
John Lovitz is a scout that's not in the movie very much, but steals every scene he's in. It's kind of a normal thing for him. I mean, where else can you learn the phrase, give the wife a little pickle tickle?
Dry your eyes. Yeah, I'm just going home, grab a shower and a shave, give the wife a little pickle tickle, and I'm on my way.
And we're talking peak Madonna as May, showing acting and dancing chops because that swing scene is the cutest ever. Rosie O'Donnell with the dry comic timing she's known for. You've got David Strathairn as Ira, played to the same level of compelling compassion as he did Eddie Seacott and so many other roles. And then there's Lori Petty as Kit. She's whiny. She's bratty. She's irredeemable. She's pretty much the biggest movie villain since Hans Gruber in Die Hard. Yep, I said it. Now, Penny Marshall delivers a film that really is perfect and works on just about every level. It's funny. It's sad. It's pointing out political problems of the day in a way that's subtle, avoiding the dreaded theme stick. You know, when you hit the audience over the head with the theme stick, think this, think this. Anyway, look, it's clearly and should be a very feminist movie. Women struggle against the societal norms of the day, often held back by other women. The charm school, the uniforms, the restrictions on their behavior, all reflective of how withholding and restrictive of a society the 1940s were for women. And while the league is helping women break the glass ceiling, it's not a panacea. We see that only white women are allowed to play. Women of color are still segregated from the game, just like Major League Baseball segregated black players. Now, much of the comedy, and there's a lot of it, stems from the fish out of water trope. The women are from all walks of life. They're rural and urban, educated and not. But all of them are new to the world of being a professional athlete and under this microscope. It's a natural way to play with all kinds of comedy. From the naivete of Marla and her unattractiveness, even though she's the best ball player.
Danny, I'm sorry.
Come on, let's go. We'll miss the train. Let's move, move, move!
What's the matter?
I can't use her.
She's great. Why not? What's the problem?
You know General Omar Bradley?
Yeah.
Well, there's too strong a resemblance.
You mean you ain't taking her because she ain't pretty?
Well, look who just caught up.
To All the Way May's open sexuality, both of these things are out of place in this very prim and proper world with strict definitions of what makes a woman. Now, there really are too many highlights to discuss, and I do recognize that I'm going to connect with this movie differently. The lens I have is that of a white guy, but the movie still definitely hit me and connected with me. It's number 5 on my list.
Give me your watch.
Could be a wreckage.
I love the scene where Dottie and Jimmy argue through signs. I love seeing Dottie really assert herself and then inspiring Jimmy to rise to the occasion. Basically, the roles are reversed. And speaking of Jimmy and Dottie, their complete and utter lack of sexual tension is so refreshing. I feel like many male directors, would have tried to cook up some fake drama where it didn't need to be there. Unless them measuring tobacco spitting is some kind of weird foreplay I don't know about. It's not, is it? And look, the reading scene where May basically uses porn to help fight adult illiteracy.
May, what are you giving her to read?
Oh, what difference does it make? She's reading, okay? That's the important thing. Now go away. Go. Shoot. Shoot. Go ahead, Shirley. You're doing good.
Thanks, buddy. Milky. Quiet. Breath.
It gets really good after that, Luke.
It's just funny. It feels like a kindred spirit to the scene where John Candy's reading Canadian Mounted in Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. If you know, you know. Dottie doing the splits and the crown reacting pretty much speaks for itself. But the funny wouldn't work as well if the movie wasn't driven by true emotion. We get an idea of how playing this game has helped women see more value in their lives than society sees in them. And all of this is in the backdrop of a world at war. The comedy, the female empowerment, all the good vibes can be torn down when the war comes home. Dottie lives with it on the daily. Jimmy trying to help her overcome her fear with logic on the bus is one of the movie's best scenes. Then, the delivery of the death notice. Jimmy has gone from reluctant manager to part of his surrogate family, and he asserts his role when he removes the insensitive delivery boy. The tension as we follow the envelope into the locker room, past Dottie, and then we feel relief. And then it's delivered to Betty Spaghetti, and it's tense and heart-wrenching, and all that emotion is brought back again.
I'm sorry, Betty.
No, George!
We're reminded that for all of the ups and downs that these women are going through, they are playing a role in a time when lives are destroyed with every Japanese and Nazi bullet that finds a target. Now, Now, we all know that Tom Hanks is one of the greatest actors ever, and I think he nailed the whole baseball gets in your soul speech. Look, those of us that love the game know it's true, and to see Jimmy use that expression to a group of women that he didn't even consider ballplayers an hour ago is a change that few actors could pull off and bring that sense of realness and that sense of truth. An actor's actor. Now the question, is Kit really a terrible person? Yes. Did Dottie drop the ball on purpose to let her score? Also yes. And what bugs me the most about it is that Kit never really earns that moment. She has zero growth in the movie. Every temper tantrum she throws ends in her getting what she wants.
Are you crying?
No.
Are you crying? Are you crying? There's no crying. There's no crying in baseball.
It's like a two-year-old. And then when she gets it, she's super pleasant and nice and still ridiculous. But Kit Gruber aside, see what I did there, Hans Gruber, Kit? A League of Their Own is pretty much a perfect movie. It sits at number 5 on my baseball movie ranking list, and it's one of those movies that I get something out of it every time I watch it. So that does wrap up this review. Now I'm going to go home and give my wife a little pickle tickle.
Are you coming? See how it works is, the train moves, not the station.
Ladies and gentlemen, please adjust your scorecards. We have a special guest in the lineup.
And we're continuing with our 4th of July celebration on Let's Get To. And we are very excited to have now the world famous. Her name is Amy Barnett. We're going to call her Ranger Amy, which is what she's referred to on the Count to Baseball podcast, Baseball by Design. Amy, first of all, thanks for being on Let's Get To.
Sure. Thanks for having me, Jim.
First of all, can you tell everybody where you got the name Ranger Amy? Because you have about the coolest job in the world, I have to imagine.
You know, I've been a ranger in different capacities for my whole career. And one day, just so, you know, when you're a ranger in the national parks, you're called Ranger blank. So I was Ranger Amy. And then, you know, there's so many people named Amy that one day someone just started calling me Ranger Amy in my normal, like, everyday life. And it just stuck. And people would say, you know, what's your name? And I'd say Amy. And they'd be like, and then, like, it would, like, yeah, there are so many Amys that one day someone said Ranger Amy. And so now people come up to me and they say, they're like, oh, you're Ranger Amy. So it's just easier to go by that. So I'm sure you get that same thing. You know, you have a pretty popular name too.
People just call me Let's Get To, and it's awkward. Hey, Let's Get To.
That's probably not it. So we're at dinner eating sushi. A glass gets knocked over by accident, and the table next to us is helping us with napkins. It's kind of embarrassing. And we talk, there's a little banter. And then at the end of dinner, the other party leaves and the server comes up and says, by the way, your meal has been paid for since you're Ranger Amy. And it was pretty fun. They said, for, you know, everything that you do for our community, we wanted to thank you, and they paid our bill. And I was like, oh, that's so cool. So
I absolutely love that. I just think it's also neat to, like in your role as far as on Paul's show, is you provide little information about if it's an animal themed mascot. And I think that's also just sort of fun. I think it's one of the things that when you have a really good show, you need to just not be about baseball. I love that you have that, you add that element to his show.
Well, thanks, Jim. I have a lot of fun doing it. You know, I just love talking to people about wildlife in general. There are so many misconceptions about it. You know, we either want to pet it or we're afraid of it. And I think that, you know, the truth and the thing that would be good for us is if we kind of land somewhere in the middle. So the more I can tell people about, okay, this is what's really happening in the wildlife world, and people are like, oh, you know, so I don't have to be afraid, or, oh, so I should be, you know, probably not petting, you know, the bears that, you know, I see around. So, you know, hopefully I can provide a little bit of insight, and that's what I like to do. So that's what people call me, Ranger Amy. I kind of translate what's going on in the animal world and bring it a little bit more accessible to people.
And that's something I just love. I thought I was going to be a marine biologist as a kid. I got to see my first humpback breach about 4 days ago. It was
so in Cancun, yeah, right?
It was the absolute coolest thing. So, awesome. No, that one was in the Bay of Alaska. Actually, it was a burr, but it was beautiful.
Cool! Wow, you've been all over the place lately.
We have. But the reason why you're on the show, not the reason why you're on the show, because I've been asking to get you on for a while, is you got to sing the national anthem, and I'm curious about that. And a lot of on a lot of levels. So how did you get the gig in the first place? How did it come up? Is that something that you do when you're not, you know, saving the world?
Saving the world. So it's been a bucket list of item of mine for a while. And Paul's always talked to me about it, you know, like, hey, wouldn't that be really cool? And I'm like, that would be a bucket. That would certainly be a dream to sing the national anthem for a ball game. So I've sung the national anthem for work events, a couple of different like banquets and things like that at work. I got the original gig of singing the national anthem when someone wasn't able to make it to a function and they called family emergency or something happened. And so they didn't have anyone to sing the national anthem. And the woman running the program said, I don't have anyone to sing the national anthem. You don't happen to sing, by the way, you know, by any chance, do you? And she was kind of joking. I was like, actually, I do. And she's like, what? She's like, come with me to the bathroom right now. She grabbed my hand and she took me in the bathroom. She goes like, sing. And I was like, okay. So I belted out the national anthem and she's just like the first couple notes. And she's like, you're in. She's like, all right, you got 10 minutes where you're on. And I sang it. And from then on, I was always the person they asked to do the anthem at work functions. And I thought, well, if I can do it for work functions, I can do it for a stadium of baseball fans. And so I didn't really know how I was going to do it. I figured it would happen when Paul got me the gig because he has so many connections in the baseball world. But funnily enough, it actually was a Twitter post by the Owls, the Northern Colorado Owls. They asked if anyone wanted to sing the national anthem, and if so, send an audition video. So I happen to have a video of me singing the national anthem. So I sent it in to their email, and he's just like, this is great. How many times did you want to sing it? So on Friday evening will be my third time singing the national anthem for the Northern Colorado Owls game. So that's kind of how it'll
You got a standing up. Gig. I love it.
I have a kind of a standing. It's fun. So I get to go in for free. And the last time I sang it, I actually wore kind of a, you know, a fitted dress and heels, and I'm out there singing and I go back to my seat. And as I'm on my way back to my seat, I see all these people coming in that, you know, got there late for whatever reason. And, you know, no one ever shows up before first pitch anyway, you know that, right? And this woman just looks at me. She's just like with such disdain, like, why is she wearing this really, you know, like form-fitting dress and heels to a baseball game? It was just so funny. I was like, I wanted to tell her, I'm like, I'm the anthem singer, but now I'm going to go and change into some baseball gear.
You'll be more comfortable. It's funny because the anthem's really important to me. I'm a vet. So depending on who's singing, a 2 to 4 minute experience but I also don't know the words, which is weird because we never sang it. When you're singing the song, though, everybody that I've known who sang it, it's a very difficult song to sing, right? Like, compared to other things.
Here I am nodding and I'm realizing I should probably talk because some of you people are listening to this on a podcast. It is a very difficult song. No matter how low you put it, you're always going to have to sing about an octave. So you have to have a little bit of a vocal range in order to make it work. You can't just... You can't cheat on it. It is what it is. And I kind of like that about it. It's a little bit of a challenge. It has a little bit of dynamic range, and it's fun to be able to kind of stretch your voice, as it were. But for me, it's a very important song. You've got everyone is, you know, it sets the tone. It sets the mood of the game. It's a little bit of a solemn, sacred moment for that part of the event, whether it's a baseball game or a banquet or some important gig. And for me, it's important to respect the song and to sing it straight. So I've had people tell me afterward, they're like, thank you for not going all, you know, Whitney Houston on it. You know, nothing against Whitney Houston. She was a great singer. She was amazing. She could do it. You know, it's what, but to me, the the anthem is not about if you've got it flaunted. You know, it's the opposite of that. It's bringing what the original intent of the song was about. And it's, so to me, you know, I sing it straight. I don't do extra frills. And I really think about the words as I'm singing it, because I feel like it's, you know, there are people who are listening to the anthem, whether it's me singing it or someone playing it on a violin, which I heard last week at a minor league game, which was really cool. Who, you know, they're listening to the song and it means something different to everyone who, you know, there's, everyone has a different experience. Just like you're listening to it and you're like, yeah, this is, you know, it has a meaning to you. So for me, it's an honor to have been chosen to be able to sing it. And I just hope I can bring it the respect that it deserves. And I'm pretty honored to be able to sing it at baseball games. And I'm hoping to get to do a bunch more, because it is an honor, really.
Well, I think it's been really cool for you to share that with us. And I know what you mean. Everybody sits down going, is she going to be on the scale of Roseanne Barr to Whitney Houston? Where do you fall? And I don't imagine you're anywhere near Roseanne. So that's probably a great thing.
No, you know, I've done in my work, I've gotten to do some TV appearances and a couple of live TV appearances, and live performances or appearances when are a crapshoot, really. You know, I hate to use that word, but it's a, you know, you spin the roulette wheel. It's, you never know what someone's going to do when it's live TV. And I have a feeling if the people on that day had known what Roseanne was going to do, they would have pulled the plug a lot earlier. That was not anything anybody, you know, wants to ever experience again. So no,
I think you're right. My last question about it, I do a lot of not singing, but I host a lot of events. I host a lot of like film festival award ceremonies, things like that. And I am one who engages with the audience. The audience helps drive everything. I know a lot of people who just basically forget the audience is even there. So where are you on that? Like, are you singing and it's just you, or are you aware of what the audience is doing while you're singing?
I am very much usually aware of what the audience is doing and reading the room. But with the anthem, I kind of just focus on the song. It's an interesting question I haven't really thought about. But yeah, I focus more on the song rather than how people are receiving it when it comes to singing the anthem. Yeah. The hard part about the Northern Owl, Colorado Owl Stadium is that it's very echoey. Uh-huh. And so it's the hardest place I've ever sung the anthem. And I have to use earplugs and I have to really focus hard because I'm hearing my voice come back, bouncing back at me. And so if I listen to what it sounds like bouncing back at me, I will really mess it up. So I have to listen to what's happening. Like, so imagine plugging your ears and having a full conversation with someone that you've never talked to before. That's kind of how nervous I am singing at that particular venue. So it's a little challenging, but every time you sing, it's a little different. You just never know what, you know, kind of acoustics you're going to have in different places. So well, I just hope I do it justice.
I am sure. Well, I'm sure they would not have let you do it a second time or a third time if you did it. All right. Last question. Random question. Please keep my faith in humanity alive. Are you a Godfather 1 or Godfather 2 person, or have you not seen either of them?
Oh, gosh, you're going to hate me, Jim. But yeah, I saw the horse head in the bed and I just couldn't watch anymore after that. So I can't do it.
Your homework assignment for next time you're on the show.
You know, it's funny because I can, you know, in the wildlife world, I've gotten a chance to look at deceased animals to see if, you know, how the matter of how they died. And I can, when it comes to animals, I can do all that, no problem. But I don't like gore, like when it comes to like horror movies, those kind of things. And so like, yeah, I can't do it.
So we'll give you the soft answer of Godfather 2, because there's no animal cruelty in Godfather.
Okay, there we go. No, Godfather 2, I'll go with that.
Oh, all right. Sorry. Well, she is Ranger Amy, one of my favorite people in baseball. You can definitely hear her on the Baseball by Design podcast by Let's Get Two's own Paul Caputo. Amy, thanks for jumping on Let's Get Two.
Thanks for having me. It was a lot of fun. I hope you have a great day.
And now, on to close it out, the right-hander from Houston, Texas, James Christopher.
So let's wrap up this episode of Let's Get To You from League Stadium, home of your Duboise Bombers and the Rockford Peaches. And I have a Rockford Peach. This is Maddie. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fantastic. First of all, what a blast out here this time.
Absolutely. It's a great day for a Bombers game.
This is your second year. What keeps, which I said before, is longer than Dottie had said was a Peach. What keeps you coming back?
Keeps me coming back is definitely the fans. I've always wanted to be a Peach. I've went to Bombers games all my life, and just to be a part of the experience was definitely something I wanted to be a part of.
And then do you see yourself staying in sports, like after school and all that stuff? What do you think?
Oh, I'm in college right now, so I'm studying to be an elementary educator. And so come home in the summers to do this is really something to look forward to for every summer to come. So
elementary school teacher?
Yes.
I'm a high school teacher. There's a special place in heaven just for you.
Thank you very much.
It's rough. All right.
It takes a certain one to do it.
It takes a little bit of something. So again, that does wrap up this episode of Let's Get To and our 4th of July episode. First of all, salute to all my fellow veterans out there. Thanks for keeping my fellow friends who are still doing it. Why? We're old. But still, salute to everybody out there. We're going to be back next week. And we have a whole bunch of new episodes coming. 2 straight months of baseball. So make sure you get out to the ballpark. Get you some peanuts. Get you some Cracker Jack. And most importantly,
Let's Get To.
Let's Get To, presented by Twitchy Dolphin Media. Creative Director, Jessica Bybee-Jedgetts. Written, directed, and hosted by James Christopher. Executive Producers, Andy Tomchesson and Scott McIntyre. Produced by Andrew Nelson, Eric Mertens, Jess Canaster. Commentary by Gary C. Warren, Emily Nyman, Paul Caputo, Ed Rivera. Music by Grace Usselman, On Holiday. All trademarks of the teams covered on this episode are the property of those teams. Look for more content from Twitchy Dolphin Media and the Let's Get To family, including Go Go Astros, Fanboy 76, Yell Fight Suey, Jerseyed, and Unboxed. This has been Let's Get To, baseball from sea to shining sea by the folks who bring you home.